here, and she's our local MP for Lambton County. You can give her a hand clap. And I love it that we have born-again Christians in Parliament.
Amen.
And it's cool, because I don't know if you know this, but Garnet has been speaking for Promise Keepers. And he just spoke at our event in Calgary, and he's going to be speaking again in Toronto. And so it's awesome to hear him tell the stories of God is leading him and directing him, and all the prayer that's happening in our nation's capital. So we're just going to pray for Marilyn before she shares the word. So Lord, we're so thankful, Lord, for Marilyn and the calling that you have on her life, Lord. But I thank you today. She's just your servant come to share a word with us. And so we acknowledge that, respect that, and honor that, Lord, and what you're doing in her life. Bless her, Lord, and fill her with your Holy Ghost as we receive from you today, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Bless you, Mary.
Thank you so much, Mark, and what a delight to be with you this morning. With respect to Garnet Genuis, I have to tell you, this is an example of God raising people up. Now, Garnet, you know, not all of us are beautiful. Garnet is sort of nerdy looking. And he has the distinction of having said the most words in the House of Commons. So he's up all the time and doing this sort of thing. And he doesn't always want to vote with the party, so he's kind of churned them up, and there's been all kinds of little things. So the party's not really, you know, always behind them. And because of that, they didn't give him a critic role. And you know, he's not assigned to a committee, so he's like the backbencher of the backbencher. But I want you to know that 338 parliamentarians voted him the parliamentarian of the year. Now, I mean, you know, here, that's maybe nothing, but if you look at the people that have won this before him, it's like Thomas Mulcair and all of these people that have been in politics for 30 years and have had these huge ministerial portfolios and everything else. Now, the fun part is that my party really gets jealous that the Conservatives don't always win a lot of these awards, and they like to try to arrange who they're going to vote for, okay? And none of the people that they wanted to get in got in. But God raised Garnet up and put him in the limelight. In the same way for myself, when I ran in the first year, they voted me the most collegial parliamentarian. So God is able to do so many things. And I take some courage in that, because this last 2 weeks has been really dark. I looked at what's happening in the world. The church in Texas, somebody walks in and kills 22 people in a Baptist church. Our governor general in Canada, our governor general stands up and mocks people that believe in God and that believe in creation. And the prime minister defends her when there's an outcry. This is outrageous when you think about our nation, a nation that was founded on Psalm 72, he shall have dominion from sea to sea and from the rivers to the ends of the earth. That is the foundation that was laid. And the people that have gone before, that have been apostles, and all the things that have been going on, and the Christian foundation of the rules of our law, all of these things have been put in place. And now we seem to be falling away and becoming a godless nation. And so I was despairing, I bet. I thought, God, we're in a godless nation. This is a godless time. These Coptic Christians over in Egypt are getting killed. It just seems like it's a godless world. How can we live in a godless world? And so the Lord began to speak to me, and he said, well, let's take a look at other people that have lived in a godless world. And he said, he brought to my mind Daniel. So I'm going to start in Daniel today, if I can find it, which I know I can. So, you know, for those of you who don't know anything about this period of time in the Old Testament, Israelites have been taken over to Babylon. You want to talk about a godless nation. Babylon, I think, takes the cake, gets the Parliamentarian of the Year award for the godless nation. And so there is all of these people in slavery in Babylon, and Daniel is one of those. And so they come to him, and he comes with some of his buddies. And the chief official gives them names: Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You might remember these guys. So, first thing they try to do is get them to eat food sacrificed to idols, right? They're big into idols in Babylon. And so, hang on. I was marching outside in minus 12 yesterday for Remembrance Day, so I brought a little bit of gravel to the voice. Anyway, so the first thing they try to get them to do is eat food sacrificed to idols, and Daniel's having none of that. So Daniel resolved, Daniel 1, verse 8, but Daniel resolved not to defile himself with the royal food and wine, and he asked the chief official for permission not to defile himself in this way. Now God had caused the official to show favor and sympathy to Daniel. What? God caused the official to show sympathy and favor. This Babylonian godless person is going to show favor to Daniel. And the official told Daniel, I'm afraid of the Lord, my Lord the King, who has assigned your food and drink. Why should he see you looking worse than the other young men your age? Then the king would have my head. So Daniel says to the guard, please test your servants for 10 days. Give us nothing but vegetables to eat and water to drink. Then compare our appearance with that of the other young men who eat the royal food and treat your servants in accordance with what you see. So he agreed to this and tested them for 10 days. And at the end of the 10 days, they looked healthier and better nourished than any of the young men who ate the royal food. And so the guard took away their choice food and wine and gave them vegetables instead. Now, that's the first part of how you live in a godless nation. You take a stand. God has given us his word. We know what his word says. If you don't know what his word says, find out. And then take a stand. Because that's the first thing that you need to do in order to hold the line. You'd think that that was enough and Daniel would then have no further trouble in this area. However, then the next stage of the game was when Nebuchadnezzar decided that they were all going to have to, every time the music played, bow down and worship the king. Didn't go over well. Daniel 3, 14. All right. So basically, here's the command. Well, let's back up. Verse 4. This is what you're commanded to do, O peoples, nations, and men of every language. As soon as you hear the sound of the horn, flute, zither, don't know what that is, lyre, harp, pipes, and all kinds of music, you fall down and worship the image of gold that King Nebuchadnezzar has set up. And whoever does not fall down and worship will be immediately thrown into a blazing furnace. And as soon as they heard the sound of the horn, flute, zither, lyre, harp, and all kinds of music, all the peoples, nations, and men of every language fell down and worshipped the image of gold that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Now, of course, at this time, some astrologers came forward and denounced the Jews. There's always somebody willing to point out that you're not going to follow the rules. If you try to hide, you will be outed. O king, live forever. You've issued a decree that everyone who hears the sound of the horn, etc., must fall down and worship, and that whoever does not fall down and worship will be thrown into a blazing furnace. But there are some Jews whom you've sent over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who pay no attention to you, O king. They neither serve your gods nor worship the image of gold you have set up. Furious with rage, Nebuchadnezzar summoned Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So these men were brought before the king, and Nebuchadnezzar said to them, is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the image of gold that I have set up? Is it true? You don't believe in climate change? Is it true? You still believe that God created the world?
Yeah.
Now, when you hear the sound, be ready to fall down and worship. But if you don't worship it, you'll be thrown immediately into a blazing furnace, or in front of the media, one of the two. Then, what God will be able to rescue you from my hand? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to save us from it, and he will rescue us from your hand, O king. But even if he does not, we want you to know, O king, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold that you have set up. We will not take a stand. Take a stand, be bold, do not fear, because we sang that song today, Mighty to Save. Your God is mighty to save. We've heard of all of the ways that he's divinely blessed, divinely intervened, divinely healed. He's the same God as he was yesterday, the same resurrection power that raised Christ from the dead. That is the same God. He is in you, he's working in you, he is for you, and you need to take a stand. You need to take a stand and follow what he says, even when it's hard. I thought when Mark was sharing his story, how it's almost like developing a faith muscle. God calls you to do things. We don't know why he waits until the absolutely worst, last possible minute to actually come and bring the thing he said he was going to bring. But it's because it's a test. It's building your faith. And when these things happen, and he blesses you, and they happen, and he intervenes, and they happen. You build up a faith that comes to the point that when you're Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and the king says, well, you know what, if you don't do this, you're going to be thrown in the blazing fire, you can say, I will not worship this golden idol, because my God is able to save me. And even if he does not, I will not bow down. Now, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego then, were thrown. He ordered the furnace heated 7 times hotter than usual. Number 7, number of perfect completion. And commanded some of the strongest soldiers in his army to tie up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and throw them into the blazing furnace. So these men, wearing their robes, trousers, turbans, and other clothes, were bound and thrown into the blazing furnace. The king's command was so urgent and the furnace so hot that the flames of the fire killed the men who took Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego up. So these big, strong guys that went and took them in got burned to a crisp. And those 3 men, firmly tied, fell into the blazing furnace. Then King Nebuchadnezzar leapt to his feet in amazement and asked his advisors, wasn't it 3 men that we tied up and threw into the fire? And they replied, certainly, O king. And he said, look, I see 4 men. Walking around in the fire, unbound and unharmed. And the 4th looks like a son of the gods. And Nebuchadnezzar then approached the opening of the blazing furnace and shouted, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out, come here. And so Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came out of the fire, and everyone crowded around them. They saw that the fire had not harmed their bodies, nor was a hair of their heads singed. The ropes were not scorched, and there was no smell of fire on them. Now, if that happened today, and you put somebody in a blazing hot fire, and they came out with their trousers and their robes not singed, would the governor general say, well, that's not science. Science dictates if you go into a blazing furnace that you're going to get burnt. Well, all I'm saying is, God is bigger than that. And this is what the Bible says, and this is what happened. And what was the result of them taking a stand and risking it? And of course, you know, think about this. Do you think they had a bad moment as they're approaching this fire and they watch the other guys go into crispy critters? I mean, you know, it would be a little unsettling in your faith. But they went anyway. And then Nebuchadnezzar says, praise be to the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and rescued his servants. They trusted in him and defied the king's command and were willing to give up their lives rather than serve or worship any god except their own God. Therefore, I decree that the people of any nation or language who say anything against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego be cut into pieces and their houses burned into piles of rubble, for no other God can save in this way. No other God can save in this way. So it wasn't just that Nebuchadnezzar believed, he then put protection out. So we're talking about our country of Canada and how things are sort of moving in a dark direction. We need to take a stand. We need to take a stand, and we need to know that God is going to protect. And what's the outcome? The outcome is protection for us, but also evangelism. That when people see that we will not bow down, that God is here to save, that, you know, there is actually fruit from all of that. So I think that's amazing. So the first thing is take a stand. The second thing is have faith. And that song that was so poignant to me, you are not alone. Sometimes you feel like you are. You're standing there in a hard place, and really, you feel alone. But we are not alone. The Bible says, I will never leave you or forsake you, right? Hebrews 13, let's just flip there. It's so good to read the promises of God because it's like life to us. Hebrews 13, here we are. Verse 5. Keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have, because God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. So we say with confidence, the Lord is my helper, I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? So take a stand and then have faith. And you develop your faith by doing what Mark was talking about today. When God calls you to do something, go. You remember he said to Abraham at the beginning, go. Abraham's like, go where? No answer, just go. So he began to go, and as he went, then the Lord led him through all the things in his life. We see in many cases when God tells us to do something, it seems contrary to the wisdom of man, right? Hard things to do. But each one of these things that we do will build our faith. And when your faith is strong, then you cannot be shaken, right? When the storms come, when people come and challenge, you will stand firm and you will walk through the fire and not be burnt. I want to talk about prayer, because I think that there have been seasons of churches I've been involved with, seasons in my own life that were devoted to prayer. And in those seasons, I can remember early in when I first came here that we used to get together and go and pray at 5 o'clock in the morning. Isn't that a prime time for prayer? But that you'd actually have to get there for 5 o'clock, so that means you kind of have to get up at 4 and get dressed at 4:30 and scramble in your sweats. Anyway, and we prayed for an hour every morning. And I look back now and I think, wow, where did I get the time to do that? That's crazy. But you know what? What was birthed out of that, in terms of church planting, in terms of the signs and wonders, the Spirit of the Lord, words of knowledge, words of wisdom, the healing that was brought to people's lives was incredible. It was incredible. And then you start to take it for granted. And then you just do church for a while. And you get busy in your life, and you stop praying. You pray occasionally when you show up at church and they stand at the front and you pray with them. You're like, right there. But in your own life, you don't devote the time anymore. Or you do fast food prayer, right? God, I got 20 seconds. Here you go. Here's my prayer. And there's nothing wrong with being constantly in communication with the Lord. But there is something that is so important about seasoning yourself in prayer. We know that the Lord has spoken words in the Bible on this very topic in prayer. And I'm going to read to you from 2 Chronicles 7. Verse 14. And if my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sin, and will heal their land. Amen. So we talk about our nation, and our nation, you know, really getting away from God, and we want to see God heal the land. It starts with us. It starts with us getting on our knees, humbling ourselves, and praying, and seeking God's face, and turning from our wicked ways. That's the hard part. We want to keep the comfy sins that we're in. We all have them. I do too. You may not know what they are, but the media will find out soon. There you go. Then you'll know. But everyone has them, okay? And God is purifying us all, so I'm not bringing a message of condemnation. I'm bringing a message of growth in holiness. Because if we want to be that people that's going to see the mighty deeds of God, to see the Spirit of God come in apostolic power on our nation, that we, each one of us, as we walk along the street and run into people, would be praying for their healing, praying for their deliverance, bringing messages of evangelism, and seeing God take the city of Sarnia for himself. It all starts with us, and it starts in prayer. So take a stand, have faith, and then pray. And then go and be the person that God has prepared you to be each one of you have had experience in your life, and some of them have been very hard, very painful experiences. And I don't understand really why it always has to be painful. But suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces godly character. So it's godly character that he's after, because you need godly character to be able to do the godly deeds he's prepared for you to do. And so take those things from the past. Don't swelter in them. Don't churn them up and be bitter. Okay? Be healed from them, but learn the lessons that you needed to learn from those things, and be empathetic with others who have suffered in that same way. You are there to heal people that have experienced that, because God has healed you from that. And so don't look back, look forward. And as you go forward, know that everything that you need has been given to you. When I never would have imagined I would be a member of Parliament, ever, ever. I never cared about politics. And I actually didn't even think Christians ought to be involved in politics, because it's a very corrupt and nasty place. But when God calls you, you have to be the person that he's called you to be, because you aren't going to be complete until you're in the spot that he's prepared for you. And when you're in the spot that he's prepared for you, and you keep your eyes on him, like Peter, remember, he fished all night and got nothing. That was a lot of work. And then when he listened and obeyed to what the Lord said, there was an overwhelming blessing. If you work away at this stuff in your own flesh, it's hard. If you're feeling like you're doing something in your life and it's work and it's hard and it's just not anointed, check. Do a check.
Check, check.
Is God calling you? Is his anointing on that? Because his yoke is easy. His burden is light. When his spirit goes, the spirit does the work. He blesses us to be able to partner with him. He's never short of money. God has lots of money. So when his anointing is on things, the funding comes, the people, the volunteers come when his spirit is on it. So if you're in a dry work, check yourself. And then I would just encourage you to not get down on yourself when you have those periods of time when you fall back into doubt. You know, you can remember some of the great guys in the Old Testament, and Elijah's one of my favorites, you know. Elijah, who, you know, back then when you were a prophet, if you were ever wrong, you were killed, right? So there's a kind of a high standard of performance. And so there's Elijah, and he's speaking out words. It's not going to rain for 3 years. Well, that's kind of sort of tough word. And then when people start having famine and suffering and everything else, and you're the guy that brought that word, I can't imagine you're popular. But, you know, to go from there, and then his next deed, you know, all the prophets of Baal are out, and he's there, and he's like, okay, you guys try to call down fire from your God. Well, that doesn't work. And now let's douse up our altar. Let's douse it up with water. Not once, not twice, not three times. Douse it up. And now I'm going to call down fire from God. Boom. Big fire. Impressive, right? What happens to him after that? Okay, they all start to chase him, and he runs away, and he's afraid, and he goes and he hides. He's like, God, woe is me. I'm the only one. I'm the only one they're seeking to kill me. This guy just called down fire from God. How can he be scared after that? I mean, God could just call down fire on everybody. I'd just be going, boom, boom, boom. Like, call it, Lord, call it. But, you know, this guy, he retreats, and he's scared. And if you think about it, after everything he saw, how could he be scared? But he was. And what did he do? He went then to where the mountain of God was. And the cleft in the rock where Moses hid himself, he went back to there. He went back to the spot where he could draw near to God. He could get the Spirit of God. He'd be close in that and hear God's voice, the little small whisper, not the big booming voice, the little small whisper, and then be refreshed to return. It was too hard for him. God had him pass the baton to Elisha, and that was okay. But if you're going along and you're calling down fire from God and you know, preventing it from raining for 3 years and things, and then you get a little bit doubtful in your life, don't feel bad. Okay, somebody else went before you. And in my life, I've had times when God was moving and it was amazing. And I've had other times that have been so dry, like the desert, that I've thought, where are you, God? Where are you? And other times where I felt like I was put in a blender and just, you know, made into a smoothie. Of course, I'm very smooth now because I'm a politician, but that's another story. So, you know, there is processing to this whole thing, but it's a journey, and God has prepared good works for you, and he's able. So here we are in a nation that's turning godless. Each of you are going to shine like lights, but you have to stand. You have to take that stand. You have to have faith. You have to season yourself in prayer and then open your eyes to see what God would have you do. For me, the story of Esther is really meaningful. It was spoken over to me early on, before I got into this politics, that God was raising me up for such a time as this. And if you think about Esther, you know, she came with what? She was pretty. That was what she brought. Okay? But God used it. God used it. And the next thing you know, she's queen. The next thing you know, she's saving her people. She saved millions of lives by what she did, her bravery, by one act on one day, just going to her husband and explaining the situation, even though she could have been killed. One act saved a people. And so God has an act for each of you to do. Who knows who will be saved by the words that you say, by the souls that are saved, by those that are healed, by taking a stand. Because if you take a stand and you become one, like when Elijah looked up and saw all the chariots and said, those who are with us are more than those that are against us. And so this morning I just want to declare some things over you. I really believe in the power of declaring. Job says, declare a thing and it will be established. And so I have on my fridge things that I declare. I have a Patricia King book. Whenever I get down, I declare what needs to be declared, whether it's victory, blessing, healing, favor, whatever the need of the day is, declare it. And when I was praying to the Lord and saying, what would you say? What would you have me declare over this people today? The first thing the Lord wants me to declare over you is strength. Strength in the name of Jesus. He says, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, and he wants to strengthen you in the Spirit. So I just declare that each of you will be strengthened in the Spirit of God. And Lord, I just ask right now that your Spirit would just extra measure flow down like honey on each person, that they would receive it, that they would be strengthened in their inner man and strengthened in their mind, Lord, to hear clearly without confusion your instructions, your thoughts, and to receive your love. The second thing that the Lord wants to declare over you is joy. There are many of you here that have been in grief. And I break the power of that over you in the name of Jesus. And I speak joy to you, that it would bubble up inside you, that there would be laughter. Even as you go this day, you will be so happy to be where you are and be full of the joy of the Lord. The joy of the Lord is your strength. And I already declared that God wants to strengthen you. And this is a way of maintaining that strength as you go. And finally, he wanted me to speak and declare over this place hope. There has been such a spirit of suicide over our city, of absolute hopelessness, of people trapped in addiction, determined that they will never get out of it, that it will be a never-ending cycle. People that have been suffering in poverty and cannot get past it. And God would say to you, I am mighty to save. I am the God, the same God you just read about, that did all of these things, and I am here for you. You are not alone. I will go with you. I am speaking hope. I break the spirit of suicide over our city in the name of Jesus. I break the power of addiction over our city in the name of Jesus. He said, I am giving you authority over all the power of the enemy. That's all the power of the enemy. There's nothing that we do not have the same resurrection power that raised Jesus from the dead. He gave that to us. He gave that to us. When we walk in the authority of Christ. And we don't always take it up. But take it up, because It will restore your hope, and it will bring hope to others. We have the light of Christ. He is the hope of the nations. He is the hope. I love you all. I thank you so much for giving me an opportunity to come and speak to you. But be strengthened. Be faithful. Be hopeful. Be joyful. Pray and stand.
Amen.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, God, God, you're good. You are mighty. You are mighty to save, but you love us. You love us even when we're not faithful, even when we don't measure up. You still love us, God, and you want to give us so much more. Help us to draw near to you, Lord. Help us to make time, create the desire in our hearts to meet with you in prayer. And let your Spirit do the work in us that needs to be done. We open ourselves to you, God. The places that need healing, those wounds from the past that are holding us. Those things that we're scared to do, God, give us courage. Show us the way. And go with us. We thank you that you will never leave us. We cling to your hand. We rest in your arms. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. I'd ask the prayer team to come, and we'd be happy to pray with you and bless you.
Thanks, Marilyn. You can give Marilyn a hand. Marilyn's going to be up here if you need some prayer. A couple other people from our prayer team are going to be up here, Frankie and Michelle. That was such an awesome word, you know, for us. Some of us need a little more faith. Some of us need hope. Some of us need to remember to pray. I get in that spot where I just get on with my week and I forget about praying like I should. So thanks, Marilyn, for that word. The Lord bless you today. Have an awesome day. We'll see you next Sunday. Saturday night, movie night here. Bring some friends, bring some kids, free popcorn. Lord bless you. Have a great day.